Welcome to the Kicking Up Dust Media podcast. Today I've got a very special guest, someone who I've known for a very, very long time, but it's been nearly 18 years since we last saw each other.
Been a long time, bro.
A very long time. He was, I don't want to say it now because it don't even sound right. look at the size of him. But he was my younger, and we ended up on the wrong side of gangs, basically. Yeah. We're going to get into all that later on. Simon has done a very long time in prison. There's a lot of benefits in this. Before I start, I want to give a shout out. Today's video is sponsored by HBG.
HBG Activewear.
Activewear is that is sportswear, right?
Yeah.
Gym and sports activities.
Yeah.
And I'm just looking at the t-shirt now. It looks like really nice quality. None of that stuff of spot up. What's it called? Shopify and all that.
No.
You can just see this is really good quality.
Yeah.
The links, as you can see on the screen, in the description box. So have a look, check it out. It's something he's trying to build. And we're going to get into everything. You know, 11 years in prison. 12 years in prison. 12. ACAP prisons. Yeah. The worst of the worst prisons. Trust me, some stories for you guys today. Yeah. So I want to introduce him, Simon Brooker.
Yeah, man.
How you doing, man?
I'm good, bro.
A long time.
Very long time.
I think the last time I remember seeing you is 2014, I think it was. Sorry, 2004, sorry. Before you got locked up.
Yeah.
I think you got locked up in 2005, right?
2005, yeah, bro.
I can't believe how fast time has gone.
It's mad, bro.
And when I saw you earlier walking, I was like, yo, this guy's the size of the hallway, you know? Yeah. So, you know, I want the viewers to kind of know you from the beginning. Yeah, you know, they know my story.
Yeah.
Where your parents, you know, just give us a quick, you know.
Yeah, so like for me, obviously I never came from like no deprived background. Mm. My parents have always been there. Yeah. But the only difference is between me and some other people is that, cool, I lived in a decent place, in a decent area with my parents or whatever, but they was never there, innit? They was always working constantly. So obviously, as a young kid, if you ain't, what do they say? The devil makes work for idle hands or something like that. As a kid, like obviously my mum and dad are always working. When I say they're working like all the time, I'm talking like nights, days, I'll be there by myself. I've got a brother, but like, he ain't really studying what I'm doing. You understand? So I hit the roads. And then from I hit the roads, like probably when I first like actually went out onto the road, I might have even been like 11 or something. And I remember specifically I come town with some of the youths from my area, from my actual area, because I used to live in Tylehurst then. Yeah. And like when I'm coming through town, there's older people in town, they see me, yeah. Because I've always been like a older looking person, innit? I've always conducted myself older, hang around with older people. So someone come up to me and they're like, bro, how old are you? Yeah. Like, who are you, bro? And I'm like, I'm no one, innit? I'm just a young kid. Like, how old are you? I must have been like 11 or 12 at the time. And I say, stop chatting shit, bro. Stop chatting shit.
You're always not big for your age,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah. They didn't believe me. And then obviously, in the end, someone's like, nah, he really is, you get me? And then from there, that's when everyone warmed to me, I was cool, I started hanging around with, well, at the time, I didn't think it was the wrong people, but I started hanging around with certain faces, moving around, and then once I got to 14, that's when shit got real.
Where's your parents originally from?
From St. Vincent.
From St. Vincent?
Yeah, Caribbean.
And, growing up, how were you at school and stuff? Because obviously you were on the road from early. So.
Yeah, so like at school, bro, I was always intelligent. I'd always be like in the top classes or whatever, but I wouldn't go. Or I might find myself in some shit, like a fight, I beat someone up or something stupid like that. I got suspended from one school. I used to go Deanfield first. Got suspended from there or expelled, one of the two. And I went Phil Green after that. But as I went Phil Green, these times is when I'm like 14.
Yeah.
Linked up around certain people. It's like, bro, what am I going to school for, bro? Mm. I can make all this money out here. You get me? Like, you're going to school to, like, the way I thought is that you're going to school to learn how to get a job or whatever and think, well, I'm making this money now. So what am I going to school for? And I just stopped going.
You know, I think as well, at the time you were growing up, there was a lot of, like, change in the black and Asian communities. I think they were just coming out of the racism era.
Yeah, whatever. 100%.
And a lot of, you know, street figures and, you know, little gangs and that were popping up.
Yeah.
And it was kind of like a cool thing to be outside. Yeah, you know, that was like the thing to do is be outside. Because them days, we didn't have social media and them things
None of that.
So I think, you know, that was the era of being outdoors.
Yeah.
Is being outside and you're going to get caught up.
100%. 100%.
So the first time I met you, so I'll remind you as well, the first time I met you.
Yeah.
So I was 18 years old.
Yeah.
I had that silver M3 sort of thing.
Yeah, I remember it.
You remember that? So I was like doing my thing on the roads and that.
Yeah.
And we were chopping up. We had a house we used to chop up food.
Yeah.
Drugs, stuff like that. So we were chopping up and it was not like not a major, but it was quite a bit of quantity of drugs. So, you know, you got to get everything done and move it out of the house. You can't be messing about. But we ran out of weed.
Yeah.
Like while we're in there, because we're breaking down quite a lot of bits, it takes a few hours.
Yeah.
So I think it was like a couple of boxes we were breaking down, 2 or 3 boxes, I think it was. So anyway, so what happened, I believe we ran out of weed.
Yeah.
And it must have been, I think, late. We couldn't get hold of that in. Yeah. You know, I think it was a drought at that time as well, whatever.
Drought back then.
And then someone said, there's some youngers around there.
Yeah.
Some youngers, they've got weed.
Yeah. Like,
what do you mean there's youngers? There's no youngers around here.
Yeah.
Because, like, you know, just for the viewers, in that era, you didn't really get young people on road selling drugs, especially his age.
Never. Yeah.
So anyway, got the number, phoned you up, and these two young kids roll up with weed, you know?
Yeah.
And then it's like, it's quite a bit, like, you know, I think you were picking up ounces, right?
Yeah, like we started getting boxes and all of that.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it wasn't like, you know, like little draws. I think we must have bought, like, you know, at least a half a Z or a Q a few them times.
Yeah.
And I never realised that you were 14 years old.
Yeah, like back then, I swear you could get like a box of weed for like, it was either 28
or 28,
yeah,
28, 26, 28. Crazy. So you were 14 that time, because I was 18, you're 4 years younger. How old was Leroy?
He was 2 years older than me, he was 16.
So he was 16, right?
Yeah.
So when I linked you guys, like, I was like, yo, you know, these guys are doing their thing, you know, like, because you were like hustling, really hustling.
Yeah.
And you wasn't working for no one, right?
Nah.
You were just picking up and doing your own thing.
Yeah, that's it,
Like, just if you could go a little bit into that, what was going on?
Basically, we're doing our own thing, and then, obviously, we linked up with certain people, those girls that I used to live with at the time. And obviously, they was doing their thing. Like, I'd never met women that was doing what they was doing. They was moving hard food. They had a lot of money around them. And they saw that I was smart, business savvy, and I was cool. So, like, they give me some money one day. They was like, yo, listen, you want to borrow some money? Cool. And I borrowed like $5,000 from them.
I think you were trying to get hold of a box of weed, right?
Yeah. And that's just how it started going from there. Like, I used that money to buy weed and then try and help. Like, obviously, it was me and Leroy and that. I'm just trying to just move it around and we do our own thing and make our money. Leroy could drive back then as well. Yeah. I couldn't drive. I used to try. I couldn't. Leroy could drive. So whatever we'd have a car. You know, back in the day, you could get like an XR2 or Ford Escort. Shit like that. Rolling around in XR2s and that. And we were just doing our thing, bro. Do you know what I mean? No one never really used to trouble us, and everyone had love for us as well. So it was cool.
You know, Leroy had a lot of love for him. You know, he was. You know, we're gonna get into a bit later on. Yeah. Leroy's someone who sadly got killed.
Yeah,
we're gonna get into that a bit later. But you know, Leroy, man, had a lot of love for the guy. And he was he was a cool dude, man.
My brother,
you know,
always smiling.
When I you know, just to quickly fast forward, when I got the call that he got killed, I was in jail.
Yeah. So
and I was like, yo, man, like, that's deep, you know, and I heard it, but
broke me, though.
Anyway, we get to that. So so this is now when obviously I was linking you.
Yeah.
We were linking. I think I'll start buying weed off you regularly.
Yeah.
I'll start coming to check you. And I thought, you know what, I'd rather give my money to the youngers, because we didn't sell them drugs.
Weed and that.
We were just doing the hard food.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
So I remember one time I must have picked you up in the BM, you and Leroy.
Yeah.
And I said to you guys, do you want to see something?
Yeah.
And you were like, obviously you're young, innit?
Yeah.
And you know it's bad, man, because it's bad influence,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So I must have just opened that bag of money.
Yeah.
It was like, I don't know if you remember that.
Yeah.
It was a whole bag of money, like, yeah, rah, you know?
Yeah.
Well, I can't remember how much was in there. Yeah. Maybe 20, 30,000, yeah, I can't remember.
Yeah.
So like we had a good relationship,
yeah,
you know? Yeah. And I kind of really like I really looked at you as like youngers, you know, try to look out for you guys. Yeah. And obviously doing your own thing.
Yeah.
And because you guys were in the weed thing,
yeah,
we didn't mess with the weed thing.
Yeah,
so you were independent.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
You wasn't working for no one. So that was another thing I respected.
Yeah.
Because a lot of other brez, older brez, in their early 20s would come on road working for people.
Yeah, of course.
And we know who they were working for, obviously. Certain, certain bigger people.
Yeah.
So I rated that still.
Yeah. Those bigger guys though, like, remember, I'm not going to say his name, but the one who used to dress all raggedy and all of that. Mm. Like, I could go and check him at 14 and say, yo, can I get this and that, and they will bless me.
They'll bless you,
they knew,
because you weren't 100%. Trying to be no one's worker.
Nah, I was exactly 100, yeah.
So now this is your 14, so if you could kind of like go between 14 and 16, like what was going on in life.
So basically when shit started to get real, because obviously we're doing our thing and we know shit can go down. We're seeing all the junkies around and all that, but we ain't got nothing to do with that.
Yeah.
We're not really dealing with, we're not dealing with that, with the hard food.
Yeah.
But we see what's going on. We see all the badness. And obviously I'm living with three women now.
Well, who are selling.
Who are selling drugs.
A-class. Yeah.
And you know what I mean? Some days taking it as well and all of that shit.
Mm.
I'd never seen heroin before that.
Mm.
Obviously, I'd seen coke, I'd seen weed, but I'd never seen heroin like that. Well, not even coke, crack I'd probably seen before that, but I'd never seen heroin. And then I see that, and I was like, yo, but they're doing their thing. And one day I left the house, because I was staying there, and I went back to my mum and dad's house, just on a one-way, probably to get some clothes or something like that. Obviously, my parents and I was going mad. They're going mad. They're trying to fight me to get back to the house and that, but I'm not listening to no one. You can't force me to do nothing. So anyway, I'm trying to get hold of Leroy that day. Can't get hold of him. And I'm thinking, what the fuck is going on? He's not answering his phone or whatever. Them time there, I think it was, you know, the Nokias where you changed the face.
Yeah.
Was it 5210?
It was 3310 or something like that.
The Ericssons and all of that.
Yeah.
So anyway, like, I don't know what's going on. Then I catch a taxi back to Ian Mercado Way. Get to Ian Mercado and I see that there's ambulances everywhere. And I'm like, what the fuck is going on? Get out of the taxi, and I'm just trying to find out what happened. I find out Leroy's got stabbed. And I'm thinking, what the fuck? Obviously, I wasn't there, but this is what he told me. He said that he's gone home because where I was staying with the girls was only like across the road from his mum's house or whatever. So he said he's gone home, and as he's come back to go to the yard, he's seen a bunch of people outside the yard. Yeah. But you know what he's like? He's just cool. He's just smiling and all that. He's just cool. He'll say hello to anyone. So he said he's walking to the front door and he see the people stood outside the yard. And he said, like, well, go on, like, hello to them. And they said hello. And he walked past them. As he got to the front door, boom, they gun butted him. Back of the head. He's out cold. They drag him into the house. When he's gone into the house, all the girls are tied up in the living room. Pillowcases over their heads. They tie him up. They're trying to, where's the food, whatever, blah, blah, blah. I don't know if they got away with, if they found anything. I don't know the full ins and outs. I wasn't there. It was a long time ago. But all I know is that my brethren got shanked.
Mm.
Yeah. And, bro, that ain't happening again.
Yeah.
That's the way I saw it. It ain't happening again. So we knew that these people, they had a thing buried in the back garden, innit?
Yeah.
And I just took that. And then from that day there, you know what I mean?
Did you know that, what's it called, who these guys were?
Never.
Yeah, I remember, because you guys came to see me.
It wasn't people from around here.
Yeah, they're from London.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah.
So I remember after it happened, you came to see me.
Yeah.
And you asked me to give you something.
Yeah, yeah.
And I didn't want to give it to you. I didn't want to give it to you.
Yeah.
But I was like, nah, I ain't giving him that. Because you were 14 years old.
I know.
And like, I said, I know you would have done what you had to do, because obviously you're young, innit?
Yeah.
Young and, you know, immature.
Yeah. Yeah.
So in the back of my mind, I was like, because you see what it was, you see when we were growing up, we didn't believe in putting youngsters on road or whatever. Yeah. If a man was on road himself, that's his choice.
Yeah.
But we wouldn't put people like on.
Yeah.
Like, yo, imagine you got a youth now, he's not enrolled in the drug trade.
Yeah, yeah.
We wouldn't bring him in.
Nah, of course not.
You know, we would try to discourage it sometimes.
Yeah.
So we didn't even really generally have workers. It was all man them, brethrens.
Yeah.
We might have an odd one here and there, but generally it was just brethren. So when you asked me for that certain object, I just kind of like, in my mind, I knew I wasn't going to give it to you. It was there. Because number one, because I think that was your first L, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Because the way the aspect I was coming from, part and parcel of the game, bro. We all gonna take an L somewhere along the line, and you don't know who it is. You're just gonna do something. You might end up doing something mad to someone who's not even a part of that, just because you're in that zone, isn't it?
I
said nah, and then them individuals end up giving you that thing.
Yeah, I took it from them.
You took it from them. And I took it from you.
Yeah, I remember. Yeah,
we're not gonna say what that thing is. You can use your imagination. It could be a saucepan or something.
Yeah.
So I remember I took it. I got it taken from you, and it got disposed of or whatever.
Yeah.
And boom. So after that happened, you still continue with the weed. You never messed with the hard food, did you? At that point,
nah.
You never.
Nah.
You just continue with the weed.
Yeah, just a week.
You and Leroy.
Yeah.
So I remember I would check you guys on a regular basis to see what you're up to and whatever.
Yeah.
And me and my brethrens, you know, was there.
Yeah.
They would be like, oh, where's your brethrens at? Yeah. You know, your youngers, you know, because they knew I should check for you hard like that, you understand?
Yeah,
so
you
told me a story that earlier that I completely forgot.
Yeah.
So you didn't even go into details earlier. I don't understand what something happened, you said. Yeah. And can you go into that quickly?
So like, I remember specifically where we was. We was in Woodley.
Yeah.
Me and you in the car, but by the BP garage. And he was like, yo, bro, hold that. And he gave me a bag. I looked at the plastic bag. I opened it, and there was a grand in there.
And £1,000.
Yeah, no one had never given me that before.
But I don't understand, like, it wasn't like a business transaction. I just gave it to you. Can't remember that.
Gave it to me. So I'm never going to forget that, bro, because nobody had never done that for me before. Mm. Do you understand? You just said, here, hold that. And I was like, what? And he's like, that's you, bro.
Alhamdulillah, I've got a pretty good memory, but
yeah.
I'm trying to think, man. Like, you know, what you're trying to
facts. Because I would never forget that, bro.
Obviously, because
you know what I mean?
I wouldn't forget if someone done it to me personally. So yeah, that we had a very close relationship, tight relationship.
Yeah.
And at that point, I think like you and Leroy were starting to get a lot of like ratings within especially the Asian West Indian community. Because you were like the youngest guys.
Yeah, yeah. And we'd be in all the raves and everything.
Yeah.
Little kids, when I was 14, I'd be in all the raves.
I was shocked when you told me you were 14.
Yeah, no one never used to believe me.
Yeah, because you were just like, you know, you just look like 16, 17 around them ages, isn't it?
Yeah.
So yeah, because I remember you come into the nightclub and stuff like that as well.
All the nightclubs. I used to go to all the nightclubs, even level ones. So that was the first one I ever went to.
Did you ever
get
asked for ID?
No, they never used to ask for ID. No. And then I'm rolling with people that's older than me as well. So
yeah, true.
They're thinking I'm the same age. I'm not.
So what happened then around that period, me and my brethren's caught a case.
Yeah.
It was quite a serious case. We had to sit down for a while.
Yeah.
This was like 2000, I think it was 2000, around 2000, I think it was. So we caught a case, and once we caught that case, I think we spent about a year in prison.
Yeah,
you know, we had to, you know, it went on for a while, and you know, we got acquitted of most charges and whatever. And that's when I remember I came out of prison, and I was like, "Yo, where's this young G's at?"
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah.
And at that time, you know, back them days, a year in prison was quite a long time.
Yeah, it was.
You know, because people are going in for a couple of months here and there. We sat down for a year and came out, and things have changed when we came out.
Yeah.
And this is when I noticed you were rolling around with Brez who we had basically beef with.
Yeah.
And I think I might have even said to you at some point.
You said it to me as well, but for me, it's like, I remember one time we were in the whip and you said it to me, but and it's like, bro, for me, you see all of that, that whatever you lot had issues with or whatever, that was before my time. Mm. I didn't know nothing about that.
And I think we'd use the music, something to do with music.
That's how I was on music, man, as well. I was on music and all of that. But all of that shit there, like, I never, That weren't nothing to do with me.
Yeah, of course.
This, because this is way back. As yeah. Again, as 90s. You were saying, yeah, like
our thing went on from the 90s. Yeah.
So I don't know nothing about that, these times. Mm. Yeah, it's just that I know. Yeah, that these men don't get on. Yeah, so I'm not gonna say nothing to no one about you. I'm not gonna say nothing to no one about them. And this is that's how I roll. Yeah. Just keep it 100, yeah, bro.
Because there was never any like
there was never no real beef going on then.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just like you guys just didn't ever like each other.
Didn't like each other and stuff.
That's it.
Yeah. And I remember like when you were like rolling like with certain individuals. Obviously, there was other individuals that we were kind of cool with. It's political on the road, isn't it?
Yeah.
So them few you're cool with, them guys there is like half 50-50.
Yeah.
One of my things was that these guys are not known to get money.
Yeah.
Like, you know, they're not going to take you down the road that you need to be going down. Yeah, you understand? Yeah. That was like my angle.
Yeah,
you know, was there. Yeah. And obviously, it's political road, isn't it?
Yeah.
There's a lot of politics. You know, it's like little countries, isn't it?
Yeah.
And whatever. Because we still have situations going on with, you know, outstanding situations or whatever, whatnot. Mm-hmm. So at this point now, so I've come out now in 01, I think. Mm-hmm. So what was your hustle at that time? What were you doing?
So again, so them time there, the main thing for me then, I'm still doing my weed, but it's music, bro. That's all I'm concentrating on. And it was like, people was talking. It's like, I had this thing like, yeah, this might be the thing that I need to concentrate on more.
Yeah.
So that's all I focused on. But again, I ended up being a dad then as well. I had a kid as well. So those people that I was around with in Caversham at them time there, I'd left that whole situation. I'd gone back home.
Yeah.
So I'm like 16 now. I'm a dad. Yeah. Like I'm back home living at my parents' house. So I'm just concentrating on the music now. That's my main thing. It's just like, that's my goal.
What type of music was it back then?
So back then it used to be called garage, but it wasn't. It's what basically turned into grime.
Grime, okay. Yeah. I think I heard a few of your tapes back in the day.
Yeah, yeah.
I think it was like a few remixes.
So I was doing a lot of stuff, man. Like a lot of stuff. I'd be traveling from here, going on like all the big pirate radio stations up in London, like Raw Mission. We was on Nasty Crew used to come on 6 till 8, I think. And we used to come on 8 till 10 straight after Nasty Crew. It's called the Co-Defendants, me and Sykes. So that's what we used to focus. That was my main focus. And I was like, yo, I can do this. But again, the streets dragged me back.
So what? So kind of like 1 foot in, 1 foot out sort of thing?
100% the whole time.
And whatever. 100%. And were you still on the weed thing or you moved on to other things by that time?
So when we're talking like, say, 16, 17, obviously once I get to like 17, 18, then moved on to other things.
Yeah, of course.
You know what I mean? Things are a little bit seriously.
Yeah, of course.
But I was never like the guy to be selling no big boxes of yay and all of that.
Yeah, exactly.
That wasn't
my
main thing. My main thing was I got something positive that positive, I could do. You get me? But I was still on the road. One foot out.
Because obviously everyone around you was on the roads.
Yeah.
Everyone you knew was on the roads, isn't
it? Exactly.
Because even at that time, there's a lot of static start going on the roads.
Yeah.
But you generally kept yourself away from
because
it.
Because I wasn't like, again, as I said, like proper, like, I don't even really talk to people about the music thing too much because they think man are chatting shit, but I was really doing this.
Yeah, I remember
like,
I heard your
I was
tapes.
Really doing this. So like you'll see like I would be going to Wolverhampton regularly, and going and chilling with Fuming, Ozzy B, Lethal B, all of them people.
Mm.
You know what I mean? We're going on radio station together and all of that. So
okay.
I seen that these guys are making it. I might could
you
be
wanna make
the next
it.
One to make it.
Mm.
Everyone used to say that to me. It said, bro, if you lived in London, things would have been different. Mm. You know what I mean?
Exactly,
that's what they used to say to me. But this is the thing. Those same people that I was rolling with before, I started rolling with a split off group now. They're still kind of the same people, but these ones are the jail man. These men,
in and out of pen.
Yeah, in and out of pen. But their lifestyle's more exciting.
Yeah.
These other men, not really on getting money.
Money,
like
but they're just like chilling.
Yeah.
And
yeah, just chilling. And only certain man, let's say one, he's about his money. The rest ain't really about that. These lot now, they're exciting.
They're up to crud.
Yeah, we go out, we party, we do this, we do that. But this was the problem, So I would have certain things. I even started getting little bookings here and there, like bookings for like clubs in Slough or whatever, Wickham. Because back then, man would know like Chubby Dread, all of them. You know the person that made Oi, the producer, all of that. I knew all of those guys. He was from Wickham. And that. So man might get like a little booking somewhere. Like I'm not major, but I'm trying to get my way there.
Get a little change. Yeah,
but like we'd land at like a shitty club. It would be shit. There'd be no one there. And obviously, them man that I'm rolling with now, the more exciting man them, they're like, oh, fuck that, this is dead, bro. There's nothing going on here, fuck that, let's go, bruv. And we go to somewhere else, what's more popping and all of this and that. So we'll just follow them. You understand? We're really and truly...
They're older than you.
Yeah, they're much older than me.
Yeah, they're but much really older,
and truly, them man, they should have been saying, yo, you know what? You stick to this thing because you seem like you got a talent for this.
Yeah, true.
No one ever done that, bro.
Yeah, so, obviously, because they were caught up in their whatever they were caught up in, innit?
Yeah, so...
I think them man were licking certain moves and
doing
whatever they were doing.
That's what they was doing. That's what they was known for. Yeah, so, like, I was like, cool.
Yeah.
And but everyone used to tell me, bro, stop being around them. Don't be around them. You be around them, you end up in prison. I didn't listen. I thought everyone was haters, bro.
Because at that time, what else was going on? You know, beefs reignite, calm down, and you know how it goes. Yeah. So, like, there was a man from my camp, and we're like, oh, F him, he's rolling with them, man, there. And I'd be like, nah, he's cool, man. And he was there, like, because I knew in it, like, he's just cool in it, and was there. Because you know, these people was trying to instigate. You know, situations and
stuff.
There's
a lot of instigation in that situation. Yeah.
There's a lot of people trying to instigate certain things or whatever. And then I tell you, I mentioned his name because you know, he's my people's. So what happened around 03, I think, Wilson Landy Road.
Yeah,
that's my brother,
My guy.
At that time, I never knew him. I never, obviously, I heard his name, but I never, I think he'd done a lot of time in prison or whatever. So what is with Wilson? He kind of knew that side, you know, that the side that we didn't really see eye to eye with. But he was his own man, innit? So he's come out now. He's analysed the road. And he's like, yo, these men are getting money. So he's come to me and he said, yo, basically, I wanna rock with you, man. Like, boom, let's make this happen, you know? So I never knew him, but I heard his name, you know? And he seemed to be someone definitely like, he wanted to get money, whatever. So anyway, cut long story short, within a matter of no time, he was taking a brick from the ends. You understand what I mean? He was taking a brick from the mandem, obviously. So he was doing his thing. So Wilson was like an elder for you, innit?
Yeah. I know him through my baby mother.
Yeah, you know him through your baby mother. So like, when all this was going on, so when Wilson kind of start linked up with us a lot, he kind of like took over his...
When he just come out.
He started
mashing.
Mashing hard, because he was coming to the mandem taking a brick. Obviously, the allegation is he was taking the brick off me, but he wasn't taking the brick off me. He was taking it off someone else. So he went back to his ends and he was really mashing paper,
mashing,
you know?
Mashing.
So I would link him on a regular basis and, you know, boom, boom, we would chat and whatever. At that time when he was doing that, where were you?
With him.
You were running with him, right? Okay.
This is what I'm saying. So you know what I'm saying about I was with this group that weren't about getting, that didn't seem like they wanted to get this money and all that, and I wanted to go with the more exciting group. More exciting groups, this them, man.
Okay, so he was a part of that. I thought he was still in jail at that time.
No. So he come out, he come out, and obviously it's like he had his shit together. You understand? So we all started rolling and doing this thing like, you know what I mean? I'm not saying that I was like
but
I was like, I'm the man who's trusted in the yard where everything is. You understand?
Yeah.
Like, I was there. We'd be going out partying, doing all kind of shit. Bruv, he was cool, man.
But he was very good.
He was different to some of the other people in that group.
You know, he was
100%.
He was very money motivated.
Yeah.
You know, so because when he came, remember when he come out, I've never met him. You know, I know the name, and that's I wouldn't even recognize him because I've never seen him. You know, he'd been in jail a few times before we were on the road or whatever. Because he's older than us a little bit, and like he kind of assessed the road situation and said, "Yo, I'm gonna go link them man there." Because at that time we had the ends on, you know, smash or whatever. So when he was kind of like, because he kind of took control of that area, basically. Because I would go link him there, and he was just running fire.
Yeah, he had
know?
That name, that name that he was under. No one didn't, they couldn't put the pin and name to him.
Exactly, yeah. So
all
he was
the junkies just calling him by some different
name. Different name.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so that was like a really good relationship we had with him. You know, we had a really good relationship with him. And also that kind of like opened the eyes of a lot of other brothers that were doing nonsense.
Yeah.
Getting caught up in little beasts, like, yo, we could really make money if we work together.
Right. That's how it from, yeah.
Yeah, do you understand? So what happened? Again, I got knocked. I got locked up again.
Yeah.
Caught a charge. Bam, I got locked up. And that's when, once I caught that charge, I got locked up. I was on remand, I think. And you were doing whatever you lot doing on road. So you lot were raving. Were you still doing the music thing?
Yeah, so... just before, not really. It's like, it's put on the back burner now because we're getting money.
Yeah.
So, and these don't want to come to the raves with me and do this thing. And they don't want to drive up to London for me to go radio station and all of that. So I still have it in me, but I wasn't 100.
Yeah.
Again, and I was working with some good producers and all of that as well. You know, like, can you remember Adrian Lowe?
I remember the name, yeah.
He changed the game. Then man, him and Narrows changed the game with this garage thing.
Okay.
So it was garage, and then man, they came out and made certain tunes like Save Soul and all of that, and that come out Sun City Times.
I remember Sun
City, when,
yeah.
And that's when the garage started going a bit darker. And it's got them,
yeah.
And bruv, them man, they're the ones who started all of that. And I'll be in the studio with them all the time.
All the time.
They treat me like a family, bro.
So, when I was in prison, I was locked up. You got caught up in, you know, craziness that changed your life, basically.
100%.
You could just simmer over it, however, just, you know, whatever, whatever.
Basically, we went out to a nightclub that night. And I always say the door's still left on the latch because I left my front door on the latch. I remember specifically, I'm thinking I'm coming back home.
You left the house?
Yeah, I think I'm coming back home that night, and I never came back for 12 years, bro. Madness. Madness in a nightclub. So basically, someone got shot, someone got stabbed.
Is it two people got shot?
One person got shot, and now one of the bouncers claimed he got grazed by the bullet.
Okay.
But that never... I think
compensation.
That never even got to the thing.
The guy got shot in the stomach, right?
Yeah, so one guy got shot in the stomach and another guy got wet across his face. And
you got 11 years life sentence, right?
Yeah, so we got done on joint enterprise.
Yeah.
Minimum with 11 IPP.
So basically for the viewers, what that means is that he has to do a minimum of 11 years in prison. That's the minimum before he goes for his first parole.
Yeah.
And then if they refuse it, every year he goes back to them again and again until they feel he's ready.
It holds you for up to 99 years. So when you look on my paperwork, like when I was in prison and that, it wouldn't say a sentence. It would just say 99 years.
99 years. Wow. Yeah. How did it feel looking at that paper?
Do you know what? I'll be real with you. You see, with the sentence and all of that, when I got found guilty. Because I never thought there was no way I was being found guilty.
Yeah,
that was in my eyes. Yeah, when I got found guilty, I was devastated.
Hit you.
I broke down, bro. I'm not gonna lie. I'm thinking, fuck, I'm fucked. I'm not gonna be real with you. Like, bro, I'd never been to prison before. Yeah, first time, blood. Man's been found guilty for this big thing. Do you understand? But when I got the actual sentence, I wasn't that bad. Reason being is because I never understood it.
Yeah, you never
the way they had the judge 11 said
years,
it. The way how the judge said it, I thought, so when I come down after the judge done the sentencing, my barrister's come and he's like, yo, I'm sorry. And I'm sorry. And I'm saying, what do you mean? Sorry for what? And he said, because you got a lot, man. And I was like, I thought I was going to get 15. I said, look, I got 11. I'm good. I'll be out in like 5.5. It's not too bad. Yeah, and he said, nah, you don't understand. You got a minimum of 11. Not 11 do half. A minimum. That's the shortest time you're going to spend in prison. And I was like, wow. Yo.
You know, just to interject quickly.
Yeah.
There's people out there that have got 3 years tariffs on the IPP and they've been in jail 15 years later.
I know men over there 18 months and they ended up
So
they're probably still there now.
That 11 years... could very easily be 20.
Easily.
You know, for me, this is where the podcast really starts. And I just want to go over a couple things. This was your first time in prison.
First time, bro.
First time ever. Yeah. You've just got a life sentence. You don't really understand the system, how it works.
No, not yet.
And they made you into a category A prisoner.
Yeah.
And I was locked up. It was a bit of a misinformation.
Yeah.
But, you know, streets talk.
Yeah, of course.
And they said they've sent you to Long Larton.
Nah.
And I was like, oh my days.
Yeah.
Like, you know, because I know you've never been jailed before. They sent him to Larton.
Yeah.
But it was just the worst. They sent you to Whitemore, right?
They sent me to Whitemore.
Same thing.
Yeah, you know. Woodhill, Whitemore.
Yeah.
Started off in Reading. So the first day I was in jail, they took me to Reading because obviously as a young
offender. Tell that part,
So as a young offender. So when I gone in there, like they got holding cells in there, from what I remember, and like, but it's not like a closed door; it's like a gate where whoever's walking past can talk to you or whatever. So I'm stood in this holding cell by myself. One of the cleaners said to me, "Bro, how come you're in there?" And I'm like, "I don't know, bruv. I don't know." And he's like, "Bro, that's fucked up. Like you know, everyone's normally in that one." I said, "So, that's when I started calling the screws and I'm like, yo, Gov, why am I in this one and everyone's over there? And he's saying, like, because you're going to be going straight to the block. And I was like, what do you mean I'm going straight to the block? For what? He said, because we don't know, because of the severity of the crime, we don't know whether you're going to be a Cat A prisoner or not. So we have to wait for the Home Office to send confirmation back to see whether you're going to be a Category A prisoner.
Right.
If you are a Category A prisoner, you can't stay here. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's why you have to stay in the block and you can't mix with any of the other prisoners until we know what's going on. So then, boom, straight to the block. Bro, that first night was mad, bro. It was just like,
why?
Where the fuck am I? Like, I'm just hearing bear animals howling and monkey noises. And I'm thinking, where? And doors banging. I'm thinking, what the fuck?
That's the other prisoners.
All the other prisoners going mad, crazy in there. And I was just like, bro, this is a madness, bro.
And you're just sitting there, like, thinking,
just sitting there thinking, bro, I don't even know what to do, bro. Just go sleep. Do you know what I mean? It was crazy. And then from there, if I move on, was I remember I got the Sun newspaper, and that it was just before Christmas, innit? So I went to prison, 16 years ago, last week.
Wow.
Yeah. Last week. Yeah.
16 years ago last week. And it feels like it's gone like that.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, it feels like that, yeah.
So, like, when I'm in there, it's Christmas time, and I got the Sun newspaper, and I bust up on the Sun newspaper, and there's this massive spread about this prison, with all these lunatics in it. So that's where Ian Huntley is or whatever, and then Bronson, man, and all of that. And I'm thinking, bro, that jail looks mad, bro. Anyway, boom. My door comes flying open, boom, like that, Bunch of screws I've never seen before. They chuck me a jumpsuit. They said, put that on. I'm like, what am I putting this on? Come on, you're going, I'm like, where? And we're not allowed to tell you. You're a Category A prisoner. You're not allowed to know where you're going now. So now I've got one of them. You know when you see that man in the newspaper and all of that with the yellow and blue, yellow and green. So
He-Man suit.
Yeah. Now the E-Man suit is yellow and blue.
Blue, yeah.
In
the yellow and green.
Yellow and green.
Green, yeah.
So they put me in that and you're going. So I'm not even in a normal prison van now. I'm not, you know, like the normal G4S one.
Yeah.
Not that. This is like
circle and that.
Nah, this is like some HMP thing, with bag of HMP screws in there with me. And we're going bare back roads and I'm thinking, where are we going to? Bro, the next minute we pull up, I look and this place just looks massive, bro. Where do I end up? The same place that I was reading in the newspaper.
It was the same place?
Knew straight away. That's the one I was looking at. And is this where Charles Bronson and them are? Bro, I'm thinking. So I'm saying, yo, is my Cody here? Is my Cody here? And they're saying, oh, we don't know. I've never heard of that person before. Yeah. I'm not sure.
They won't tell you.
And then I just go through. And I'm like, yo, this place is a madness, bro. So I walked straight through, but obviously man's from the road and all of that, yeah. So I got my screw face on or whatever, and I'm big them time there as well. I used to go to gym, so I'm quite big and when thing. I walk through and it's surgery time, yeah. And I walk in and obviously I'm just over my face to push up. One of the guys in the surgery, yo, blood. I said, what, you play rugby? And I was like, nah.
Man said rugby.
Yeah, yeah, and I just walked off, yeah. I'm thinking, what the fuck is he asking me if I play rugby, bruv? Yeah, so I walk up, walk off, I go to my cell, and I close the door, yeah. And I close the door, I hear knocking on the door, knocking on the door. Man busted the flap. Oh, go on, blood. Yeah, who's this brother? So he's come now and he's like, blood, like, come out, bro. Come out yourself and all of that. You get me? He's like, I'm such and such. Like, rare. It happened to be, have you ever heard of them mob youths from up north side? That was the name of the gang, Mob.
I don't know.
Yeah, he's with them, a couple of them, man. It's like, come out, bro. He's just, and then some, but he was from Tottenham, I think. Anyway, long story short, that's who I started rolling with. It was all cool. He's had bear jokes on the wing or whatever. But in the end, me and one of the guys of the group, we got the biggest sentences on the whole wing. Mm. So I got mine and my other bridge, and he got 30. Yeah. 30 straight.
Right.
Yeah, 30 wreck. And it was just like, rah, this is real. You and get me?
After you got sentenced, how long did they keep you in Woodhill?
So I swear I was in Woodhill for like 2 years. I think so I was there, yeah, like they used to make jokes. They used to make jokes and say, you're like part of the furniture. Because I was just there, like, and people don't normally stay there for that long. It's normally in and out, you get your sentence and you go.
Mm.
Yeah. But I was there for a minute. Mm. And then the next thing, boom, straight to Whitemore.
And still Cat A prisoner?
No. I wasn't Cat A prisoner no more. So why are you sending me to a Cat A?
They sent you to dispersal.
Yeah, why are you sending me there for? And I'm not even a Cat A prisoner. Yeah, obviously, like,
so you were category B prisoner basically.
By then,
yeah,
I was Cat A until after the trial. Mm. Then they dropped our status to B Cat.
They still sent, and still sent
me to dispersal. And obviously, I'd watch certain things on TV and all of that, Crime Watch and all of that. Some of these like real G's, like head figures, like people that you don't want to mess around with. Mm. Yeah, like. And I see them on Crime Watch as soon as I land in Whitemore. Bro, I'm seeing all of these people.
Mm.
It's like, bro, wow, this ain't no joke.
You know, the time that you were in prison,
yeah,
that I think we're talking now, what, 2008, 9, yeah, around them times.
Yeah.
It was very violent in prison.
Very.
It was extreme. And you went to like one of the worst jails, yeah, you could go to.
100%.
And your first time in jail,
yeah,
and you were very young,
yeah,
still,
yeah,
doing a big sentence. What was running through your head?
So, obviously, like, when I was in Woodhill, I was stressed. Had bear shit going on outside and all, yeah, of that.
Everyone has
like,
that.
I don't know, you know, Stars people, and he says, everybody acting funny like I ain't coming home.
Yeah, exactly.
You get
that's,
me?
That's just
exactly
the nature of
it. It was like, everybody's acting funny. My girl, everyone is just bear stress.
Mm.
I'm thinking, blood, how the fuck am I do this, get through this? And I get to Whitemore. Man are asking me, how long you got, bro? And I tell them, I got a minimum of 11. Are you going home soon, bro?
Soon, because you've done 2 years by that
what?
Time, right?
Yeah, I'm like, what? What are you talking about? Like, bro, you're going home soon. I'm like, how long are you doing? Bro, I'm doing 30. Or, bro, this guy, he's doing life in prison for a murder, but he's murdered someone else whilst he's in jail as well.
Natural
so
life.
These guys are never getting out. Never. Mm. And that's when it said, that's when, yeah, I turned a negative into a positive. Because
mm-hmm, yeah.
I'm there in this madhouse, yeah. But you know what? There's light at the end of the tunnel. I'm going home. These guys are never going home.
You know, once you're in prison, you have to kind of make a subconscious decision.
Yeah.
Either you're going to go down this road,
yeah,
and just be in a madness, yeah, and with the sentence you had, you probably would never go out, or you not go out for 20, 25
yeah,
years.
Yeah.
So that was the road.
Yeah.
Or the other road was, try to somehow find a positive out of this.
Yeah.
At what point in your sentence did you say to yourself, I've got to make this into a positive.
So when I was in Whitemore, and as I said, it was Christmas time and all of that, and you know, on TV, Channel 5, they used to play World's Strongest Man and all of that. It just so happens, a few years ago, I was sat right next to one of those guys that I used to watch in prison on World's Strongest Man. He sat right next to me not long ago. Like, I used to watch it and be like, yo, these guys are doing their thing and all that. I might have to start doing this muscle man thing, you know, because I've always been going to the gym, like, from before I went, and I know, that, bro, I grow quick, And, like, again, like, when a man will tell you, like, we're in on the Wyoming, So as I said, like, we're 18 to 25 on there. And, bro, no one could bench as much as me. None of that.
It was just like, so you're still actually a YO?
Yeah.
Never realised that. Yeah. Sorry, Mike. That went over my head.
Yeah. That's another thing what people need to understand about the difference in sentencing and all of that. Yeah, I was a young offender, bro. I wasn't even an adult. Do you know what I mean, bro? Wasn't even adult.
So when you're in Whitemore now, you're with the adult prisoners.
Even in Wood Hill. So in Wood Hill, you got 2A and 2B.
Yeah.
2A, you're 18 to 21, and then when you get 21, you move over to 2B. So I was on both of them. I done 2A and 2B. So 2B is 21 to 25. So yeah, I was a while. When I got to Whitemore, I'd become an adult now. I'd probably be like 21 or something when I was in Whitemore, 21, 22 maybe. And it's like that thing, what I was saying about I'm watching this thing and thinking, yo, I can really do this. Because, bro, like, no one in the gym is as big as me. Like, they must have something. I get to Whitemore and I'm like, I can really do this thing here now.
They have the equipment and stuff.
Because you can cook.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you cook your own food.
you can cook your own food, and you can get whatever supplements. As long as you can prove that it's from an actual reputable company, you can get whatever supplements, But I just started blowing up, And that's the reason how the way I got through prison was like, I have no concept of time. None. Even to this day, I have no concept. Most of the time, I don't know what day of the week it is, what year, any of that. All I know is today is chest, tomorrow is legs. That's all I know. Yeah, and I
focus
live,
on that.
And I live 3-hour increments, so I have to eat every 3 hours. So that's all I done. Yeah, I look at the time. Yo, it's 2.5 hours. I've got to eat in half an hour. Yeah, that's the main thing. What am I eating? And then what am I doing in the gym? And then I used to have screws, you know, like when you go journaling, like you have screws that are bodybuilders and that they do the bodybuilding thing or whatever. That's just what they do in their spare time, all the time. They'd be coming to myself saying to me, bro, even like in coming off a visit, strip shirts, they're saying to me, bro, listen, honestly, you need to do bodybuilding when you get out. That's what you have to do.
Yeah.
You're different, bro. It's like, and I, whatever, bro, he's chatting shit.
Yeah.
I ain't going on no stage in them pants. that's all I say. I never took none of that shit seriously.
Yeah,
yeah. But the whole time, all I was doing, I was just enjoying it because it's just something that I could
something
focus
to
on.
Do. Yeah,
I could read all the magazines when I'm there. I could take the supplements. I could eat the food. So yeah, bruv, you understand what I'm saying? That's how I just stayed focused the whole time, and throughout the whole time, that's just what I done.
You know, we're gonna get into more, but I just want to just say something here, really important. You see, like, the prisons that, you know, he's been to, I've been to, you know, the young kids on road now, you know, especially the ones who are like 14, 15, 16, 17, influenced by this whole gangster life.
Yeah.
Look, I'm going to tell you, these jails are not fun. Like, you see the most horrendous things in these prisons.
Yeah.
And, you know, real life is not a music video and it's not a movie. Like, you see, when you're in it, you're in it, and it's not fun. You see, with Ghost, it's Simon, aka Ghost, of 42. One thing I really praise Ghost for, when you're in that environment of prison, you're surrounded by only negativity.
Yeah,
there's no positivity there because either people are talking about what they're gonna do when they get out.
Yeah.
The ops is always some type of insane criminal activity that is getting talked about.
Yeah.
So to be able to elevate yourself out of that situation for like 9-10 years
yeah.
and focus is like very difficult in that 100%. Environment. I see very few people cross that line and like, you know, just focus and say, nah, I'm sorting this out, you know?
Yeah.
And like, for example, when I was in prison, I think a lot of the crud I got up to is because I was bored.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was a way, you know, like you said, the gym thing.
Yeah.
It was just a way to pass time.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, because really thinking about it, some of the stuff, like we would organize parcels over the wall like it was a military operation.
Yeah.
You know, you got to get the bray on the road, you got to come to this guy, the guy's got to wait on this side. Mm. And I don't, at some points now when I look back, I don't even think it was about the parcel. It was just about conducting the whole thing.
Excitement of it all.
And feeling something, you know? Mm-hmm. So, what you done, and the thing with you is as well, you had light at the end of the tunnel because you were young when you were inside.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know?
I never thought that though, because I had all the older people telling me that same thing, and I used to be like, nah, I'd rather be old, bruv. Your life's over. That's what everybody says, that you're old and all of that. Like, you've already done what you need to do.
Yeah.
But nah, it might have been a blessing in disguise for real, because, bro, if I never went to prison, I wouldn't be who I am today, and shit could have been a lot worse.
Worse.
A lot worse.
And you said, another question I want to ask you, a deep question.
Yeah.
You know, you said a lot of stuff you go through, obviously, because you're doing a sentence, but then obviously stuff's happening outside your family or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, your best friend,
I
also consider him a friend, Leroy. Yeah. He got killed.
My brother, yeah.
Yeah, so he got killed while you was in prison.
When I was in Wood
Hill. Yeah, we're not going to go into what happened, and you know, obviously.
I don't really even know.
Yeah, we're not going
to. I was never there, but I don't really know what happened, to be quite honest.
So when he was killed, how did you get the news, and what did you feel?
So that's when I'd just been sentenced, yeah, and I'm finished. Like everyone thinks I'm finished or whatever. So I'm just jail. This is my life for now. Yeah. So again, I spoke to him maybe a week before or something, and he just said to me, "Bro, I wish you was out here. Certain things are going on. I know they wouldn't be going on if you was here."
Mm.
Anyway. I was phoned my girl one day, and she was on the phone crying. I was like, "What's wrong with you?" And then she told me, "Oh, Leroy's dead."
Damn.
And it just broke me, bro. And I was on the wing with one of his cousins from High Wycombe as well.
Oh, seven, I think it was, right?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, roughly, yeah.
And it was just like, bro, you can imagine the things that are running through my head. But that broke me, bro. That broke me, because that's like my brother, bro.
Especially you were like the situation, you can't even do nothing. You can't phone.
I could do. There's nothing I could do. I don't know. I can't hear I can't hear the truth from no one.
There's a lot of rumors circulating and stuff like that.
It's just a mess, bro.
Because I remember when I heard about it, I was locked up as well.
Yeah.
I was like, "Rah, my man got killed." It's kind of deep, because you know, he was such a he was such a good brother.
Yeah.
You know, and he was always respectful to people.
100%.
You know,
and always smiling.
Yeah, always smiling. I even saw a picture of him the other day. He was smiling on the picture still.
Always with his gold teeth.
Yeah, with his gold teeth. Yeah, yeah, with his gold teeth.
Yeah.
So these were part and parcel of the struggles. Yeah. How about your parents? How were they dealing with it?
Bro, obviously, like my mum always said to me, she done the sentence with me, bro.
Mm.
You know what I mean? She stayed 100 the whole time, and if it wasn't for my mum, like. Because everyone else had left, you know what I mean? That was the only person that I could flip in. You know what I mean? You might need a little canteen or something like that. You know, like, or phone credit. You know mum's going to bless you with that, like, once a month or something. It might not be much, but it all means something. You know what I mean? I had one cousin that every day, every now and then, he might even just send me a fiver, bro.
Mm.
But that meant something. Because I'll be real, you know, one of the most fucked up things for me in prison was, blood, like, I will be sat there and the screws will come on the wing with the mail, yeah? And they'll be sat at the table and they'll be shouting everyone for mail, and people will be going, getting mail, and I'm sitting there thinking, yeah, I'm going to get mail. Oh, yeah, I never got mail. Never.
That hurts, right?
That fucking, yo, bro, they'll never get no mail, none of that, bro. It's like, it was dead. I was just left there to rot. I know, listen, people was talking some mad shit like, yo, he's finished. When he gets out, cars are going to be doing this and cars are going to be
flying
doing
and all
then
that.
Then car ain't doing none of that shit.
Yeah.
Come on, I never saw no cars flying. I ain't seen no cars flying yet.
You know, I don't want to really go too deep into this.
Yeah.
but especially for the kids, you know.
Yeah. Do you know one thing what I do want to just state, yeah? Where we skated across, yeah?
Yeah.
Especially for the kids, yeah?
Yeah.
You see this J-Lars thing, yeah? Especially the ones that I went to. Bro, honestly, like, as we was talking before, you were seeing man actually get melted, like, people...
Explain that.
So you see, when you're in Whitemore, everybody's on edge. It don't matter who you are, it doesn't matter a thing, you're on edge, you have to be on point. If you go to the gym and you're training and your back's turned, you tell your brethren, make sure no one doesn't come up behind me, yeah? On the wing, yeah? Bro, you don't know what's happened. Someone might have their TV playing a bit too loud last night and it disturbing the guy next door to him. Bro, the next morning he's in the kitchen, he's getting ghee, which is butter, clarified butter. So we get a load of tubs of stock, yeah? They throw it in the pan and boil it and burn it until it turns into actual oil. Like, that's ghee, yeah? And then they'll just go and chuck it over a man. Clean. They look like Freddy Krueger. Their whole face will melt off.
Melted off.
There's nothing you could... What can you do? When them people are screaming, what can you do? There's nothing you could do. Like, they're finished, bro. I see certain men, and I was like, raw, when I first got there, what happened to him? And I was like, yo, man, burn him up. It's not a joke.
And the thing, what I was about to say as well, is that when you're doing them type of sentences,
yeah,
you know, 15s, 20s, yeah, 25s, whatever,
yeah,
is your family really doing the sentence?
Yeah, 100%.
Would you?
100%. That's who it affected more than anything.
Yeah, because man, they might come check you here and there, but yeah, their life goes on.
Yeah, man, them left, bro. And those were my J's, bro.
And this is what the youths need to understand.
Those are my J's. Another thing what used to piss me off, as well, as bad as the male, yeah, which I'm grateful that my parents will come and see me. But bro, you think your gal and all of that's waiting for you all that time there? She ain't waiting for you. Bro, and if she's saying that she is, bro, you ain't know what she's doing. All I know is I used to be sat on a visit, yeah, and everyone's there hugging up and kissing up with their girlfriend. I never had no girl come visit me, not, and I was on my J's.
Mm.
You get me? And I would sit there thinking, how come I can't get no girl and hug up with no girl? Again, another blessing in disguise, because yeah, I had no stress.
That was my next question. Yeah. So, being enclosed, not having... being in closets for 2 years, being, you know, it didn't really impact me on a personal level,
yeah,
because I never had kids, you know. My parents were not coming to see me because I asked them not to. But obviously you had a child.
Yeah.
How did that impact you? Like,
every month they will bring him up. Every month I'll see him without fail. Yeah. But again, this is a baby. I know him as a baby, yeah. And then he's just getting older and older. And when I got out of jail, yeah, and I was laughing and joking with him one day. I said, yo, can you remember when we used to do this and do that, yeah? And he turned around and he looked at me and said, Dad, I don't never remember you ever being out on road. As far as I was concerned, you've always been in jail.
How old was he when you went to prison?
3 years old.
He was 3 years old, I remember nothing.
Yeah, that bunned me, yo, bro.
And when, like, obviously he knew, but when did he kind of, like, understand you was in prison?
So I don't obviously, when he was coming up and he was a kid, you tell them something different. I don't know the exact time or whatever. I think he might have googled me or something, and then he found out because everyone was telling him some bullshit and he wanted to know about his dad. So I think he googled me, and then they come up what I was in jail for, because I think they wasn't telling him what I was in jail for. It definitely would have had an impact on him.
And how old was he when you came out?
About 15.
Wow, yeah.
About 15.
That's just a complete change.
Yeah,
like, he's like nearly a man now.
Exactly.
He was, wow. So you're coming out of jail and he's the same age when you were going out with crud.
Yeah, when I had him and all of that.
That is deep. You know
what I mean? Yeah, crazy.
You know, being in, you know, from Whitemore, you know, you went around a few jails and stuff like that. Without saying any names, what's a couple of crazy things you've seen in jail?
Bro, I've seen... as I said, I seen man get bun up. I see one incident that happened, I never actually witnessed it, but, like, all I know is that, bro, maybe I should have kept my mouth shut about it, but I didn't even know. I saw someone talking to a screw one time in the corner, and then when they saw me, they looked at me like, oh shit, And I said, oh shit, to myself as well. And I just cut, yeah. And then, because I wasn't even thinking of no consequences, I ran back straight to the wing and I told the man what I see. Yo, I see my man. Bro, I heard later on that day when he went to the gym, bro, a man slammed a 50-key dumbbell on his head. Wow. Vegetable. You can imagine how bad I felt as well.
Yeah, of course. You're saying what you saw, isn't it? Come on.
I didn't think no one was going to go do that.
And that's the nature of them jails, man. People are doing mad sentences.
Because ain't no one getting out. So you ain't getting out, you ain't got nothing to lose.
You got nothing to lose, innit?
You got nothing to lose, bro. So
When you started to get into your sentence 4, 5, 6, 7 years, when you got around that type of time, did you start seeing the light at the end of the tunnel?
So again, as I said, I just stay focused on certain things. Once I started moving from ACAT, I went to a Lifer jail in Portsmouth, which was a BCAT. And then that's when I started to realise, you know what, this is different, because all them other jails that I'm in, Whitemore and all that, they're in the middle of a field. You understand? You ain't seeing shit. You know what I mean? Yeah. And it's just a lunatic asylum. But this one that I went to, it was Kingston in Portsmouth. It was a Lifer jail.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's a lot of weirdos in there, snitches and all of that, because a lot of them Lifer jails, you see all of that. But again, there's a certain group of us and we all kept ourselves to ourselves, whatever was going on with all of these other people, whatever, weirdos. But the reason when I knew that I was coming closer, because, bro, you see, when I look out my window, I can see the street, bro. Mm. And I can see people lined up at the bus stop.
That must have been a big
yeah,
thing, right?
Yeah, I should love it. It sounds stupid, but I should love it. Course. I just sit at the window and watch people out there like, yo, you get me?
I remember once in prison it snowed.
Yeah.
You know, just to see that snow, it was like, you know, people understand that looked like a big thing, you know?
Yeah.
So once, obviously, you know, you got close to your release date.
Yeah.
And whatever, you really maintained yourself well in prison, right?
Yeah.
You know, you made a decision.
Yeah.
I'm gonna, you know, follow these rules,
and
I'm gonna get out of here. You know, you didn't front and say, oh, I'm gonna be a bad boy.
Nah, you said, I keep myself to myself. Yeah, I'm just cool. I, you know what I realized in prison? Yeah, you see, when you're gonna find yourself in trouble is when you try and be someone you're not.
Exactly. Yeah,
that's it.
That's it.
Always be me.
Be yourself.
You'll never ever meet me trying to be somebody else.
And you've always had a likable character.
Yeah, I'm just
cool. Understand when people take to you and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So, obviously, being in prison, you know what? I would definitely want to do another episode. Mm-hmm. You know, definitely. Get a bit more details about prison and stuff like that.
Yeah.
A lot of my podcasts will stay around an hour and a half.
Yeah.
You know, when you, obviously now you go through the prison system, you're DCAT. Yeah. You're gonna come out now.
Yeah.
You just done 12 years behind the door.
Yeah.
Like a lot of things changed in 12 years.
Yeah.
What did you think you were gonna do when you got out?
I knew what I was gonna do.
Oh, you knew from there?
Yeah, I knew what I was gonna do.
Bodybuilding.
I done it. I knew from. So as I, you want me to tell you the whole story? Yeah, go on. It's a madness.
Yeah, go on.
So as I said, throughout the time, I'm meeting various people and they're telling me, bro, you have to do it. It'll be prison screws, it'll be prisoners. I was in one jail with a guy that done the universe and he was like, bro, you have to do this. And I was like, I'm not doing it. He said, bro, if I get out and you're out, we're out at the same time, I'm going to make you do it. Nah, bro, I'm not doing it. Anyway, when I got to DCAT, still, I maintained a good physique. I met this Indian guy, them and they're ballers still, like they make crazy money, and he's like, yo, he said to me, he's like, I want you to train me in jail.
Yeah,
I was like, all right, cool, because it's gym orderly, cool, like a personal trainer, innit? Couple tins of mackerel, whatever, you know.
Yeah,
what
game on it, yeah. The mackerel. You know, we need the mackerel.
Yeah, train him. You get me? Then he's like, bro, swear down, I've never seen no one in prison like you before. Swear blind. You see people big and all that, but not like nah. He's like, you know, I know this bodybuilding judge, innit? Yeah. And he said, I'm gonna send him your picture. And I was like, whatever, bro, you chatting shit.
Joe, that's what men do, is chatting.
Bro, my man fully got a picture to the guy, and this guy is like the top judge, bodybuilding judge in England, one of the top guys. Yeah, he's got a picture and he said, my man got like that in there. So he's like, yeah, and he's like, fuck off, you're chatting shit. He really got that in there. He's like, yeah. He said, bro, tell him when he comes out, yeah, come straight to me, yeah, and I'm going to guide him and try and take him to the top. So I was like, all right, cool, yeah. So I used to speak to him every now and then, whatever, like messages or whatever, bits of advice was cool.
Yeah.
And he was like, you have to do this. You know what I mean? Like, you got to do this. So the first day I got out, yeah, I had a town visit or whatever. I drove straight to his gym. Straight there. That's the first place I went. Ain't going nowhere else, you know.
Yeah.
I went straight to his gym, to the gym.
And seriously, we, first place, yeah?
Yeah. Pulled up out there, yeah. And I'm with my brethren. My brethren is driving me. One of my brethren who was in there with us, but he just got out.
Yeah.
See, because we all did every single thing, yeah. Every single thing, like the clothing, the body build, everything was all discussed in prison. A group of us, all of us, like, bro, you've got to do this. Yeah. Everyone's telling me this. That's a whole group of us. So when I'm getting out, my man's already got one of the guys that we always have these. He's out now. He's like, I'm going to take you there. So we've driven straight to the gym. We pulled up, yeah. And like, I see this girl walk out and I'm like, yo, I seen that, she's on the internet and all that. And I see this other guy, he's diesel walking.
Yeah.
I'm saying to my brother, no, I can't go in there, bro.
Yeah.
I can't go in there.
The professionals.
He's like, bro, he's stupid, bro. He's like, nah, bro, louder. Let's do this, man. What's wrong with you? So I went in there, yeah. And I spoke to the guy and the guy was like, bro, like pose for man, tickle just, and he's like, trust me, you got it, bro. Do you understand? And then after that, it was like, I'm getting out at such and such time. Yeah, like fully released. He's like, cool, we're going to put you in this show. And that's it. I went straight from
prison. So it's literally straight from prison.
Yeah, well,
I never realised that.
Pop in the deep end, yeah. So like, again, after that, I started, so that's the first time, the first time I come out on a townie or whatever, but then there's other gyms. So I don't know if you saw on my Instagram a few days ago, there's a video of me deadlifting a car.
Okay, now I didn't see that, no.
Yeah, I posted that up. That, yeah, was the first time I ever went to King's Gym. Yeah, I'd heard about this gym with a car in there.
Yeah.
And you could lift it up. So I was like, bro, I'm going to do that.
next
town visit, I'm going to do that. So I've landed there, I've gone there, and there's this big white guy in the gym, yeah? And I walked in, he said, yo, you ready for war? I looked at him, I was like, bro, what the fuck is this guy going on? Because remember, I just come from jail.
Yeah, that means something else in prison.
Yeah, you know what I mean? So anyway, I'm doing my thing. Like, I've got it all on video, bro. It's all on that. I've got all of this, all recorded. My bedroom was recording it for me. The person that took me to that one was someone from Reading.
Okay.
Yeah, a certain man know him still. He's like, hey, he's a cool guy. Yeah. No one never have a bad word to say about this guy. It's cool. He took me there. Yeah.
Okay.
So again, this white guy's come up to me at the end and he's like, bro, what gym do you go to? And I'm like, bro, I'm going to be real with you, bro. I'm just out on day release. And he looked at me and he's like, fuck off.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I'm being serious, bro. And he's like, no way. He's like, bro, when you get out, you need to come and see me and I'm going to help you. And I'm like, nah, I already got someone. He's like, how do you know him? And he's like, well, you're in good hands. And then from there, as I said, when I come out, I started, I went straight into the show. So we booked the show as a Kent Classic.
Yeah.
This is what you're getting ready for. No off season, fresh out.
Straight into it.
Yeah. So I've got like 6 or 8 weeks to get ready.
Yeah.
Something stupid like that. And obviously I'm shook. Bearing in mind, see this white guy that I was telling you about?
Yeah.
He's definitely the, if not one of the most famous bodybuilders from England.
Mm-hmm.
He just done the Mr. Olympia, which is the Super Bowl of bodybuilding.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Like these, so when I gone to this other gym, the guy with the judge, I'm posing for them. He's got me in front of some other pro bodybuilders. Like these are stars. Like it's like, bro, now you gotta pose for this guy. Mm. No. And he's like, yeah. And I'm like, bro, I don't really know if this show thing's for me, you know.
Yeah.
I
don't
want to try and get smoked in it.
Yeah.
A man looked at me and laughed. He said, bro, you're not going to get smoked, yeah? He said, bro, the only way you're going to get smoked is if there's a freak in the show, and you are the freak.
Seriously.
Yeah. And I went in there. I done the intermediates, yeah. So I done the, what was it? Over 90s intermediates, yeah. But there was a mix-up, and they put me in the category below, which had even more people in it, even more sharp. And in bodybuilding, like, if you get to the top of it, it's not about weight. Nobody cares about your weight. Mm. It's just all you look about.
How you look here.
And I went on there and I won, bro.
You won it.
First place, bro.
First time.
And yeah, and then got an invite to the British Championships.
Oh, wow.
Straight off the bat.
So I never knew that. I thought you started the bodybuilding a few years after you came out.
Nah. Straight off the bat. So that was it. And then it's like, so from that show, I remember I'd only been out a few months, yeah, and I do that first show. I get invited to the British Championships. And then in the British Championships, I do the British.
Yeah.
I got third place in it. And I was kind of upset because I said to myself, one of the judges came back and I was like, why did I get third? I can't understand why I got third. Because it's like, I ain't got no missing body parts, especially back then. Like, the people are going to have got no missing body parts. If you're just going on condition, yeah.
What do you mean missing body parts? What does that mean?
All right, so it's like, you know when you see a guy and he's big, but he got little arms.
Oh, that's missing
or
body.
He's
I get
he's
you.
Got a big chest, but he ain't got no back.
Yeah.
Or he ain't got no legs.
Yeah.
The time there, I'm complete. I never had no injuries, nothing. I was complete.
Yeah.
Do you understand? So the way that I saw it, what the hell are the judges looking for? If they was looking for just conditioning, then the guy who came first place, he definitely should have won because he was in better condition from me. So I wasn't upset about the first place, but the second place. The guy who comes second, I felt like he should have never been there. So I was upset. And I said to the judge, like, what happened? Like, why did I come thing? And he turned around and he said...
What number did you come?
Third.
Third, but that's still good though, man.
In England. Yeah, in Britain. You get me? Well,
you just
come out of jail.
Just come out of jail,
this
man.
So when I said to the judge, I said to him, like, bro, like, not this is not the judge that got me into it. This is one of the other ones.
Yeah.
Who was actually judging the show. And I said to him, why did I get third? And he looked at me and he said, just remember, where you've come from and what you've done in such a short space of time. You've got people that have been trying their whole lives to do what you've done.
Exactly.
To be happy.
And you've just done it like, Cowboy and Joe, like, broke up weights and everything, So that's deep still. I never realized you actually started from Joe.
Yeah.
So now that's your like, that's your focus, bodybuilding.
Do you do
personal training as well?
I do personal training, online coaching.
So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put the Instagram link in the description box so the personal training man can hit you up if they want to, get some
online
advice or coaching
like
or whatever.
Dieting and all of that stuff.
Looking back now, it's been a long journey for you, a long journey. Yeah. When you look back now, do you have regrets,
Yeah, I spoke about this yesterday. In my bedroom in Nigeria.
Yeah.
He got deported to Nigeria, innit?
Okay.
Spoke to him yesterday. I hadn't spoke to him the whole time I've been out. He searched for me and he found me. Mm. And they all messaged me. Like, yo, what's going on? It's all good. And he said to me, bro, do you still do the music thing? And I'm like, nah. And he's like, what the f-? He's like, bro. Everyone says it to me. He's like, bro, that was your thing, bro. That was your thing. Like, your shit was fire. But I gave up because, when I had this thing with this judge, and had the opportunity, a man is telling me, because it's like, for me, the way that I looked at it, at the time, I didn't know the full ins and outs and the politics of everything. All I just knew is that this guy, it's like Alex Ferguson coming and saying to you, yo, you can play football.
In bodybuilding, he's like
that's
a main
what
guy.
That's what I was like at the time. So it was like, yo.
Yeah.
It was like, I'm going to have to listen to this guy because he obviously knows what he's talking about.
Yeah.
So the only regret that I have here is that I stopped music because music is my love, my first love. Mm. You understand what I'm trying to say? And it's like, I said to my, when I got this opportunity, I'm a man that I'm all in innit.
Mm.
All in. Friendship, everything. I'm all in, 100. So I can't do the both of them.
Both of them. You got to focus on one.
I focus on one. And this one seemed to be the opportunity. And bro, listen, as much as I say I regret not following the music or whatever, bro, bodybuilding has done a lot for me, bro.
Oh, yeah.
100%. Got me through my sentence, yeah.
Definitely.
It's kept me focused. It's kept me out of trouble. It's helped me to travel the world. You know what I mean? Like, you know, I compete in other countries and all that, like Italy and all that. I just come back.
I saw the Instagram, yeah. You know what I mean?
It's like, bro, if it wasn't for bodybuilding and I was doing music, you think I'd be able to do that?
When
the music's just bare trouble.
Yeah, exactly.
I'd probably find myself in trouble because you're hanging around 100%. The same kind of people.
People, exactly, yeah.
Do you understand?
That's the music industry.
Yeah, that's the music industry. So for me, nah, I can sit there and say, what if? But yo, no matter what, yeah, I've been dealt, like, I've worked for it and I've been dealt with some good cards.
You know, you definitely turned a massive negative, huge negative, into a positive.
100%.
And, you know, it's good you done it because, you know, you still were pretty young when you came out and stuff like that, you know. Just a question, like, look, no one can tell you nothing about Joe and stuff like that.
You know,
you've done it the hard way. You know, you've done a life sentence. You're still on life license, right? If you were to say something to the kids, you know, to the younger generation, what would you say to them about that street life?
Bro, I'll be honest with you. First thing, yeah, especially when it comes to violence, yeah, violence is the dumbest shit ever. Because you're not making a penny from it. Mm. And you're going to get the biggest sentence ever over some bullshit. So violence, that's dead, yeah? The other thing is, whether you're doing anything you're doing, yeah, if you sit down in jail, yeah, for long enough, just know that all of those man them that is supposed to be your man, they ain't going to be there, bro.
Mm.
They ain't going to be there. You might have one that may one be cool,
two, yeah.
But most of them ain't going to be there. They're going to try to fuck your girl. They're gonna try to steal your shit.
You know,
it's like, bro, it's dead, man. That life is dead.
You know, one thing, like, my man kept it real, you know, where you said about prison, like, you know, your visit, ain't no gal visiting you, nothing, you know?
Yeah, none of that.
He kept it at 100, man, because, you know, people understand the emotional side of prison as well.
Yeah.
Like, everyone's dealing with it in their own ways, isn't it? You understand what I mean? And it's just not like, you know, they'll make a little BBC program about Joe and, like, it looks fun. Nah. Yeah. It's not fun.
It's
not
fun, bro.
Because people are dealing with a lot mentally as well, man. Yeah. You know, since coming out, have you ever been tempted by that road lifestyle again?
Nah.
Nothing.
No, nothing like that. Like, nothing in that world appeals to me.
Yeah.
Like, what am I going to do?
Because you...
I would be, like, in my 30s, what, shot in pebbles.
Exactly, yeah.
That's an idiot thing.
Do you understand what I mean?
Life.
You've basically seen...
You know what I mean?
You've basically seen, like, both sides now, isn't it?
Yeah.
You've seen where that life ends, and 100%. Now you're trying to do something positive.
100%.
And you see... And even though, like, sometimes it might not even seem as exciting as them. Yeah. You understand what I mean? But no, boy, you got, like, peace of mind.
You ain't gonna keep watching over your back.
Exactly.
Yeah? The man's gonna try and roll up on you, or the fed's gonna kick off your door. Bro, you can sleep easier at night, bro.
You know, one thing I will say, man, from the first time I met you and Leroy, you know, I had a lot of respect for both of you, you know? Like, you know, you just had a good character to you guys.
Yeah.
And the way you, like, kind of, you had, like, respect for your elders as well and stuff like that, man. Mm. And I always, like, respect that stuff, man. And, you know, it's crazy, like, looking back now, like, that was...
So long ago,
21
bro.
Years ago.
21 years ago, bro.
It was nearly exactly 21 years ago.
Yeah, bro. Yeah.
And I can't believe where it's gone.
Mad.
Do you understand? Like, it's just that.
No, we would have never thought we'd have been here.
Who would have thought that?
I mean, never.
Do you understand?
In a million years.
And the mentality we had back then to the mentality, you know, is changed. Do you understand? I mean, we didn't have to change our mentality. We could just stuck with it and say, yo, let's just ride this until the wheels fall off or something. But when I look back now, like at 21 years ago, what we were doing, what we were talking about, you know, just. You see, now you see the insanity behind it. Because we really believed it could work.
Yeah. Bro, I'll be honest with you. I get more fulfillment, out of, like, some of the messages and some of the stuff that I get. Like, people message me, tell me that I inspire them.
Yeah.
All across the world, bro. I'm not, like, people in America and all of that. Like, as you see with this clothing as well, like... I sponsor a school athletics team in the Caribbean.
Tell us about a little bit about this.
So for this year, like, basically, a friend of mine, he was a printer as well, and he makes clothes. We were sat in DCAT together, and he was like, "Bro, you have to build a brand for yourself." Like, what you're doing, you have to like capitalize on it and have your own brand. You ain't be there wearing Nike all the time and paying all this money. We can make the same kind of quality stuff, yeah, for much cheaper, and it's your own thing. You know what I mean? So if everyday life, you see me walk around wearing my own clothes, stuff, bro. Yeah,
that's good though.
My own clothes. Maybe not if I'm going out, but I don't hardly ever go out anyway, yeah. But everyday life, I'm in my own clothes. You know, it's like when I walk in the gym and I see man wearing my clothes and all of that. Mm. Or I walk in the gym and like I see myself on the YouTube, like man, like, yo, that's you on the screen, and all screen, that. Yeah, bro, come on, man. That's much better than the feeling that I had on the road every minute I have to keep looking over my back.
If this blows,
yeah,
I want my grand back. I'm joking.
Yeah.
What's it called? But nah, man, you know what? It's good that you know what? This is what I said. Yeah. Man has been on me, certain man, to get merch.
Yeah.
I said, listen, I'm not gonna go to them places. You know, everyone's doing the same thing.
Yeah.
Everyone's, you know, certain companies you go to is giving the same quality to everyone.
Yeah.
If I did go that down that line, I want to do something proper like this.
100%. Like
my own thing, you know?
100%. Like, you know what? One of the things that my proudest moment for this clothing brand is, again, like I've mentioned it, like I sponsor a school athletics team in the Caribbean.
Okay.
Yeah. And every one of their athletics meets, they be wearing my shit.
Seriously? You actually sponsor one?
Yeah, I'm going back there. I'm building a gym for them, bro.
Whereabouts in the Caribbean?
In St. Vincent.
Seriously?
Yeah. Right in the red zone where the volcano went off. Yeah, because we had a volcano eruption last year.
My children's grandmother is from St. Vincent.
Yeah, bro, right in the red zone, right where the thing is.
That's I'm with you, man.
Yeah, bro, like, so this, like, the first time I went, like, because they get no funding. They have nothing. And you know that some of these kids, yeah, like...
They got nothing.
But they could be a hidden talent. I don't want nothing from these people at all. I just want them to succeed.
I never knew that.
So like for the clothes, like I sponsor them with all the clothing. So when they go to their athletics meets, they're wearing HBG clothing. Mm. And now in the next few weeks, I'll be back there again because I setting up a gym for them in the school. Nothing major, bro. I'm not rich, so I can't make them a £1 million thing. But gym, I sent good equipment over for them to be able to do their thing. So that's, I go there in the next few weeks and set up the gym. I present the gym to them and more clothing, and that's for free. I don't want nothing for that. I just want them to live life and be happy.
That's serious, man. I never even knew he was doing that.
Yeah.
And the gym is going to be open in a few weeks, he said.
Yeah, I'll be there in a few weeks to open
the gym. Yeah. Nah, seriously.
Yeah. And so after Christmas,
your probation is okay with you traveling and stuff.
Yeah, because it's work.
It's work, isn't it? Yeah. Now, you know what? Try and document that, man. I would like to. 100%. I would definitely like to have a look at that, man.
Yeah, man. So, like, I'll go there in the next few weeks. We'll set up everything and then boom. Because they message me all the time. That's the whole thing. Like, I get messages from the kids and all of that saying to me, yo, really appreciate what you've done for us and all of that. Mm-hmm. And nobody's ever taken, like, their time out to try and help us. So, we're grateful.
Got to try and look after your people.
Exactly,
man.
Bro. So that's more fulfilling than me than being on the road shutting pebbles or shutting 100%. Weed. And
hopefully, man, it gets blessed, man. It goes far, you know?
Yeah.
I hope that, man. Is there anything else you want to add?
No, we got another episode anyway.
Yeah, 100%. You know what? I want to go a bit.
There's more stuff.
Yeah, I want to go a bit deeper because, you know, especially the prison experiences 100%. And stuff like that. I know, like, there's a lot of stuff. You see, like, this platform. I really hope that some of these younger guys watching this, they could watch and say, surely not every single one of these guys is wrong. Do you understand? You see what? I am not saying you're not going to have fun on road.
No.
I had fun on road.
Yeah.
I am not going to say you're not going to make money
because
people made money on road. Yeah. You know? But what you give...
Yeah.
How do I explain this? You know, the risk for the reward and risk factor. What you have to give to yourself, to the road, is not worth.
It's not, bro. The streets like, always win, bro.
You know, the house always wins.
House always wins, bro.
And this is like my message. You know, no one's saying, you know what, I'm going to be, I'll be very honest with you.
Nobody's ever beat the street.
Bro. No, streets undefeated.
Come
you know?
On, bro.
You know, nobody. Street is undefeated. You know, sometimes, you know, in the comments, you get some, you know, strange people. Now we know someone who's, you know, pick a million bricks. I'm like, listen, if someone pick up 1,000 bricks, you wouldn't be in my comments.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Like,
and yeah, all right. If that even is true, maybe for now.
For now, yeah, exactly. Yeah,
how long do you think they're gonna last?
You know, so this is the thing I always say. Like, I'll give you. I'll be very honest with you. You know, everyone's different.
Yeah.
Everyone has different strengths and weaknesses.
Yeah.
I miss some parts of the road.
Yeah.
Even to this day.
Yeah.
You know, the way I was living. Obviously,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
My life was based around an adrenaline rush. Mm. I was in a constant, you know, from the minute I wake up.
Mm.
So when I left the road, I noticed that adrenaline just went.
Yeah.
And I kind of missed it.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I mean? You know, when you're rolling about with certain things it's always, you're always on edge, innit?
You know,
you understand what I mean? So like, I kind of missed that adrenaline rush.
Yeah.
Like I miss going to the clubs.
Yeah.
Like part of me misses that, you know, but that's where all the drama happens. You ended up in prison because of a nightclub. Because we are attracted. Because you know when normal people hear, like, what do you mean? We've been going to nightclubs all our life.
Yeah.
We are attracted to certain type of nightclubs.
Of course, yeah.
And sooner or later, drama's gonna happen there.
Yeah, for real. Yeah.
So, you know, I'm not gonna sit here and front and stuff. Yeah, there's aspects you may miss and whatever.
Yeah.
But what you have to give to the street off yourself.
Yes. Yeah,
it's just, it don't make no sense. Like, for example, you gave 12 years of your life. Like,
spent a third of my life in jail.
You spent a third of your life. What's that worth?
Exactly.
A mil, half a mil, 2 million. What's it worth?
Yeah.
You can't really put a price on that. If someone said to you right now, okay, go to jail for 12 years and they'll give you a million, you wouldn't go to jail. No one in the right mind will go to jail for 12 years for a million.
Exactly.
You understand? Yeah. In their right mind.
Come on, you can make way more in 12 years.
Yeah, but even if you can't, make half of that.
It's the, bro, no,
who's
going to
do that?
Bro, nothing. You see all of that, yeah? No matter how much money you make or whatever, yeah? There's certain things, yeah, in this world that money can't buy.
Yeah, of course, man.
Man can't buy back them times where I miss my first day at school and all of that. I can't pay. Money can't buy that back.
Nah, man. So this is the thing, man. So I just ask them, man, to use your own mind.
100%.
Don't let, you know, people, the neighborhood, like certain type of music influence. You think for yourself, man. Yeah. Is this what you want?
Yeah.
And do you really believe if you go down that road, knives, guns, drugs, you think you're gonna live that life for 10 years without any madnesses and drama, trauma, prison? Come on, man. It's gonna come. And one thing Styles P said it,
uh-huh.
said about prison. It's easy to go in, it's hard to get out.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember that. I think it was Styles P.
Yeah.
And your life can change in literally 1 minute. Your life changed in 1 minute.
Well, split second.
1 minute you were there, kicking back in the rave.
No, exactly. I never went out with no intention to do nothing.
And 1 minute later, you're on the run. Do you understand what I mean? So this is what
I didn't even get to go on the run.
Do you understand? So this is how life changes, man. Yeah. But you know what?
Come on.
It's been 18 years.
Yeah.
17, 18 years, I think it is. 2004,
yeah.
So 18 years. Man, you know what? I was happy to see you again.
100%.
And in a much better...
Better kind of circumstances.
Better circumstances or whatever.
100%.
But man, you know what? I'm not going to lie. Been really good to see you, know?
100%.
I was like, and even to see a man after 18 years,
do
you understand what I mean? Like, certain man, like... After 18 years, I rubbed out.
Yeah, of course.
Did you understand? To see him after 18 years doing well, positive things, man, it kind of inspires me. I'll be honest with you.
Yeah.
You start.
Yeah.
I mean, you see, like, I don't know how you go to the gym three times a day.
Yeah.
You know, when he was talking, talking about the gym thing, I say, I'm going to gym tomorrow.
Yeah.
You understand? So, man, you're, like, seriously,
come
now,
on.
You know?
Come on.
I need to go to the gym.
Yeah, you ain't got nothing to lose. Bro.
Me
it's
now.
An
come
hour
on,
of
man.
The day, bro.
Nah, it's love, man, seriously. Yeah. And I'm definitely going to have you on the show again.
100%.
We can do other things and stuff like that, man. Yeah, so, but all the links for his personal training, the clothes, is all going to be in the description box below.
Yeah.
Thank you for listening, guys. Hope you enjoyed that. Simon, aka The Ghost.
Come on.
Peace.
Bless.